Now, our next guest has been able to connect with the spiritual world since she was just 4 years old, predicting everything from life-threatening illnesses to helping find missing persons.
Most people that look at me say, well, you don't look like a medium. I say, well, what is a medium meant to look like?
Helen Parry-Jones is one of the UK's most renowned clairvoyants.
People often ask me, how do you see the spirits around you? Are they there all the time? And I say to them, yes.
Born with the ability to communicate with the spirit world, Helen has been using her gift to help people for over 25 years.
I'm Helen Parry-Jones. My work is beyond boundaries.
She's assisted police with several high-profile murder cases and has appeared on countless television shows and speaking tours.
From an early age, I could see and feel things that other children probably can't.
As well as writing two best-selling books.
Now, Helen is down under for her new speaking tour, Beyond Boundaries, and we're thrilled to say that she joins us now in the studio. Helen, great to see you.
Morning. Thank you. Great energy here today, isn't it?
Yeah, listen, fantastic. We always try to bring the energy. You just read
you.
It.
Thank you.
Helen, first of all, let's go back to where is it? You were 4 years old when you first read psychic, had psychic powers. How did they manifest? Because I was asking someone this the other day, do you hear things? Do you see things? How does it manifest?
Well, I think I've probably always been spiritual right from the word go. But for me, obviously, we don't recollect with that until we're actually cognitive and we can actually make sense of it. My first recollection was when I was 4 years of age and I saw my guide, Sam. My auntie had an outside privy and I had to go to the loo, and when I was trying to get back into the kitchen, there he was sitting on the step. And he was this gorgeous black man, but in the 60s in England, there wasn't very many black people around. So that was a shock in itself. And then he explained to me that he was my guide, that in fact I could see people that other people couldn't, and that he was there to explain everything to me, and that my gift of clairvoyance from my very early stages was a way to be able to lead into the healing, because without the gift of clairvoyance they wouldn't be able to explain the healing to
me. Right, right.
So it's kind of like,
so what do you mean,
that
when
was
you say healing
thing.
What are we talking about?
Well, everything I do is involved with healing. I feel there's a lot of people out there giving messages or whatever, but actually for me it's all about being able to deliver that message, and if I'm speaking to you, you have to go and implement that in your day-to-day life.
So it has to be a positive reason.
Yes, right. Exactly.
And you're trying to get people not just like, here's your messages, give me $50 and move on.
No.
I've got to sort through this out with you and make sure that you walk
for
away
me,
healed.
For me, it's all about therapy. I'm not an entertainer. I do it with a very great integrity. And for me, it's about that person having a reason to come see me. So if they speak to me, whether I'm speaking to you now, whether I'm giving a message, whether I'm giving hands-on healing, it's all about the healing message.
Right.
But what makes me very different and very unique is the fact that I see beyond that. So if you can imagine that I've grown up with all of this and I'm at the stage I am now, which is many years on, I have to say, then I feel and see more. And so when I actually heal people now, I see and feel more.
Helen, you've worked with police on several very high-profile cases. Just tell us about some of those.
Well, I never seek out the police. I mean, murder cases, particularly with children, we're mothers. We know how awful that actually is. And for me as a mother, I find it really disturbing, and it's heart-wrenching. But there are times when people have had links with me, and to be honest, the very first case I worked on, I actually did my first public performance. My father had died very young, and I was actually gaining sort of charity funds for the hospital, and for me it was about giving clarity to my gift to be able to know that I was doing it properly. So I stood on stage in front of my first 200 people, my first audience, to prove to myself, really, more than anything, that I wasn't just crazy or anything or imagining it. And the girl came through. It was two girls that stood on the stage next to me. And initially, it was a guide that stood next to us. And she had a rose in her hand. And when I looked at her, the rose turned to blood. And it just poured through her hand. And the next minute, I saw these two young girls, 15 to 16 years of age, standing next to her. And she just said to them, OK, you can go and touch Helen's arm now. And as this one girl that walked forward did so, I just felt this enormous rush of horror. I have never, ever felt anything like it before. It was extreme terror for me. And I really felt the girl's last few minutes of her death.
Mm.
And she actually then went on to tell me, now this was a girl that was only missing at the time.
Yes.
And she'd said her name was Anna Humphreys. And she went on to explain that she'd smashed the windscreen trying to escape from her abductor. She gave the name of him. She gave the details of him, everything. And she said, there's someone in this audience that can help me. And everybody kept saying, no, 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 there's nothing here. But she pointed this man out and she said, you can help me. And he was, no, no, no. And it was the lady next to him, she kept nudging him. And eventually he stood up and he said, well, actually, I'm a CID officer and I'm actually working on this case, but she's missing. She's reported missing and not murdered.
Yeah.
3 days later, they found her exactly with the details that I gave her that evening. And he actually stopped the evening and said, please stop the evening to give me these details at the back of the audience. And there were 200 people there as witnesses.
Well, just quickly, we do have to go. When that all happens on stage, you're describing that in like real time. Does it happen in real time, or does it all happen quickly and you know it and you? It's like times. Like I'm thinking of movies, Helen. Does time stop like in the movie and things are still going?
It can,
and everyone's
actually
just sitting there for 5 minutes going, Helen's not talking.
It's not instant coffee.
Right.
And so for me, it either comes through or it doesn't. But what I find is, you know, when you're going out with your family and you're sitting at a table and you're having dinner, you're wrapped up in their conversation. You don't really notice anyone else in the background. For me, it's very much like that. I can switch off a little bit now.
Mm.
Not in the early days, but now I can. And it's as though all the people in the restaurant that would be around you, if you looked up, you'd be able to focus on them. You'd be able to hear them.
Right.
So that's what it's like for me.
Amazing.
It's incredible. Your work is incredible. For tickets to Helen's Beyond Boundaries tour, you can go to helenparryjones.eventbrite.com, and you can also meet Helen this week at the Mind, Body, Spirit Festival, which is on in Sydney. We wish we had more time to talk to you.
I'm actually in Melbourne as well. I'm guest speaker in Sydney and Melbourne.
And Melbourne.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.